to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above.
Well, good morning, Grace Bible Church. Morning, Chris. Would y'all please stand and join us? Strength will rise.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Strength will rise
upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
Our God,
you reign forever, our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You come lift us up on wings like
Everyone needs compassion.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of
Savior.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
So take me.
Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine your light.
Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Savior.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Good morning again, GBC. Great to see everybody here. Please take a couple of minutes to greet the people around you. light of the world.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
King of all days.
King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became whole.
Here I am.
Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
I'll never know.
I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see.
Last time, I'll never know.
I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Good morning once again, everybody. You may be seated. Hopefully everybody has had an absolutely fantastic week. I'd like to invite Wayne and Alexandra up to the front, if they could at this time. Listen, sometimes we sing songs that focus their attention, say, maybe on the holiness of God or the character of God, who God might be, God's interaction in our life. Sometimes we focus on songs that deal with the theology of God. All of them are good. The song that you're going to hear next deals specifically with the theology of Christ as our Savior and the shedding of His blood. When you make this personal, Jesus takes your sins upon Himself, and then He takes the wrath of God upon Himself to deal with that sin, and He sheds His blood for us so we can have then relationship with Him. Of course, He rises again from the dead on the third day as the capstone of the reality of that theology. It's all rich. Now, if you're a Christian, the words to the song that you're going to hear, they're going to be rich and full and have a lot of meaning. If you're not a Christian, you might be thinking, really? Somebody has to shed their blood for me? And only Jesus, as perfect man and perfect God, can do that. We might like it to be a different way, but it's not. And so we come this morning and we thank Jesus for his shed blood for us. Wayne Younghans, his daughter-in-law, Alexandra, will be singing for us this morning.
So this song means a lot to me because as a boy, I was painfully aware of my sin, but I had no remedy. I went to church and did all the sacraments, all the stuff, but there was no life there. When I heard the gospel, I understood it wasn't about me. It was about Jesus. Turns out there was nothing I could do to make myself holy. But Jesus, a boy like me, breathed the same air, walked in the dirt and worked with his hands, but never sinned. And having lived a sinless life, he paid for the things that I did. That price was his lifeblood. I've seen the lifeblood of many young men spilled on the streets of New York City. I was a paramedic, and there was very little I could do for them in those days. Their blood was one final futile testament to their existence as they lay there without hope. But Jesus' lifeblood was neither futile nor hopeless. And because he was the God-man, the power of that blood is infinite. Because of that gift, you and I can have life and a closeness with the holy God. And instead of living in fear, we can live in his favor. That's an amazing thing, to walk in God's favor. There's really no words that you can put together to thank God for a gift like that, but this song will be an effort. Was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight.
So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to give it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I own, broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. You took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. Now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life, brought me from the darkness into glorious light.
There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood.
nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood. The blood that calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood. The blood. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light.
Thank you, Wayne. Thanks, Alexander. That message, of course, resonates not only here, but internationally as well, because the Lord is after the hearts and the souls of everyone from the beginning of time. And we have the privilege to be able to share and to serve in the ministry of the gospel, again in our own backyards, and having the privilege of being able to share that globally as well. Some of you have spent time on the mission field. You've gone to different places to share the truth of the gospel. Some of you are doing that here. We have some trips that are coming up, and we'll be sharing a little bit more about that in the weeks to come. But there's an immediate trip that's taking place at Fresno Valley Christian School, and we have a senior, somebody who's attending here at GBC, and her name is Summer Sweet, and she is going to be part of that team of 16 that is going to be going on the trip. And so, Summer, at this time, would you like to come up and tell us a little bit about the trip, when you're going, the costs, and what you're going to be doing? And you're going to be bringing your sister with you as well, because she has something that she's going to talk about as well. Hi, Cherry. Good to see you. You don't have to be nervous, even though that's very difficult looking out. You just keep your eyes on your sister maybe the whole time. Absolutely. This is Cherry, and she has a little bit of something to share. If you all recall about the shoes that you were bringing in a couple of months ago, she has a little update for you on that.
Hi, my name is Cherry Sweet. I'm in fourth grade at Fresno Valley Christian School. This year I joined our Early Act Club, where we do service projects. We decided to collect shoes for Souls for Souls. With your help, we collected 1,824 pairs of shoes that didn't go to a landfill. It was turned into $15,500 that provides a month of food, housing, and education for 22 families. Thank you for all the shoes.
All right. Hi, everybody. My name is Summer Sweet. Cherry's my little sister. I'm 17 years old, and I'm a senior at Fresno Valley Christian School just up the road. My family and I have been part of the Fresno community for the last 10 years, which is kind of crazy, and we've loved being a part of the family there. And then for my own family, I have my mom, Angela, right there, and then my sister, Cherry, and my brother, Grayson, who some of you may know, and then my dad, John, also goes here. He just couldn't be with us today, but sure he's here in spirit or something. Anyway, we've been at GBC since January of last year, and we have loved getting to know the community here. It's such a wonderful experience and a unique thing that GBC has, and so thank you all for being a part of it with us. So I'm here today to talk about a missions opportunity that I have this summer. So it's through my school, Fresno Valley Christian School, and at our school, the goal is to train up men and women of God to be lights in the lives of others. And while they do a great job of training us for this in the classroom, they also understand that some of the most important training we can receive can be done outside of the classroom, in this case, on the mission fields. This is Fresta's second time doing this particular trip, but my first mission trip overall, and I'm super excited to be going on it. So, when is this mission trip? It's going to be in June, from the 15th to the 23rd, and we're going to be traveling to eastern Guatemala to be part of a ministry there. Now, where specifically in Guatemala might we be going? We are going to Hope of Life International, which is a ministry based in the little town of Llano Verde, Guatemala. It's in the eastern portion. Their ministry reaches all over the eastern Guatemala area, and they provide life-saving resources to people in need and also reach out to them with the gospel, because that's really the most important thing we can give anyone. Now, why Hope of Life? Why would we choose them? Because for the last 30 years, their mission has been to save lives through the gospel and through resources. This is really our goal as Christians, and it aligns so perfectly with why we're doing this. And so Hope of Life is just perfect for our mission there. And every staff member they have is dedicated to the mission. They continue to this day, and it's really just amazing what they do there. So what will we do there? We will be packing food bags that will be distributed to families all over Guatemala. This food is gonna last these families for about 2 weeks, which is really awesome because a lot of these families don't know where their next meal is coming from. And so the fact that we get to provide these resources for them is so exciting. We're also gonna be spending time with the orphans, the elderly, and the malnourished through various forms of ministry around the HOL campus. So on the campus, they have housing for people who kind of can't take care of themselves. They have an orphanage where there are many kids that need care, and we're gonna be getting to do a VBS for them, which is gonna be super fun. And then we're gonna be talking with some of the elderly people and some of the people who are just struggling with nourishment and helping them to receive their physical needs so that we can then tell them about their spiritual needs and to fulfill them in that way. We'll also be working in local feeding centers to share aid and evangelize and doing the same, visiting door to door around the local communities to tell them about Christ, which is our whole purpose in the first place. And you'll see in the little sidebar on the left there, we're trying to raise $7,000 to do a free medical clinic and to pack 100 of these food bags. So the medical clinic, we have to be able to purchase medical supplies and medication and all that stuff that people need. And it's even for stuff as simple as like a common cold. Whereas we would get that here, it's like, oh, sniffles, that's awful, but then you get better and you're fine. But people in Guatemala die from common colds. So this medical clinic would be a huge advantage for them to have. And then the food bags, going to feed families for 2 weeks, that would just be a huge blessing to all of them. And now the part I'm sure you're all are fully aware is coming. How can you get involved? Well, first and most foremost, I would ask that you please pray for our trip. Please pray for our leaders, pray for our team, that you would give us wisdom and discerning in how to communicate with these people. Please pray that all the people we come in contact with would have seeds planted and that God would reap the harvest in his time and to be with the travel and the finances and everything involved. And also, if you feel so led, please consider giving financially to this trip. We would be humbled to receive any financial donations that the Lord leads you to give. So I know it says up there the total cost for each person is $1,800, but we've done some initial fundraising already, and through the generosity of people like yourselves and the grace of God, we've lowered that cost to $1,550 per person, which is pretty awesome. However, that is still kind of a lot of money for a 17-year-old like me, so I would greatly appreciate if the Lord would put it in your heart to give to this trip and to help me be the hands and feet of Christ in Guatemala. And additionally, if I were to hit that cap, which would be crazy, the rest of the money will be going towards that $7,000 for the other projects that we're going to be involved in while we're there. Pastor Chris, I'll let you come up and talk about the other thing now.
Just hang out right here.
Yeah.
So it's important for us to understand that when
a lot of our young people and other folks from GBC go on these trips, I always ask them if they're willing to put skin in the game as well. So I mean, Summer's willing to do that, whatever it takes. I mean, she is going on this trip, so between herself and her family. But if you're led to do that, you can send a check right to Fresno Valley, or you can put cash in an envelope in the back and put Summer's name on it. You can write a check to GBC, put Summer's name in the section on the lower left, and we'll make sure that she gets that money as well, and you get the tax benefit going into it. You have a team of 16, and again, they're leaving on June the 15th. That is a Saturday, and if you could, you know, think and pray about getting those resources in over the next month or so, I know that they would greatly appreciate that. And of course, praying for the team as they go in. Now, as is always the case, anytime somebody goes on one of these trips, we also ask for a follow-up. So you will be back up here again, all right, talking to us a little bit about the trip once you return. So thank you very much, and blessings to you and the team. Thanks. Awesome. Thanks, Summer. Some of you who have been here at GBC for a little while, you might be thinking, the name Sweet, where have we heard that before? Summer's grandparents, Bob and Joy Sweet, served here for a number of years before relocating to North Carolina. And they were impactful to me personally and to here at GBC as well for so many years. And it's just a blessing to have you guys. But certainly, Bob and Joy were just awesome, and I'm not telling you something that you didn't already know before. Amen to that. Let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll dive into our text for this morning. We're grateful, Lord, for the privilege to sing, to talk about you, to fellowship together, to hear about those that are going on trips to share the truth and to provide physical sustenance to those who have needs. And we certainly pray for Summer and the team as they prepare, that you would use them in an amazing way on this trip. We ask that, Lord, for all of our missionaries, you would do a wonderful work in their lives as they minister and share the truth of the gospel to others. We ask, God, that our hearts and minds would be drawn into your word today, that you'd speak to us from the truth of the scripture, and that we would walk out of here encouraged, challenged, to be a little bit different than the way that we came in. And we ask you to do this work in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Book of Acts, first century work. Kind of some of the stuff that Summer's going to be doing, others of you have participated in as well. God is still at work here and around the globe, and he commissions us in Acts 1:8 to take the truth of the gospel around the world. Own backyard, other countries. He says, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the globe. From there, the pages of Acts opened up to the spreading of the truth of the gospel as persecution set in, as this dynamic element of the lives of the people that were changed began to take over and they wanted to communicate Christ. And then you get to chapter 6, 7, and 8, where the church is growing so rapidly and there were things that needed done, and so others were coming alongside to meet the needs of individuals, just like what happens in any other church. Stephen was called upon to serve others. What he didn't know is that shortly after he would commit to that call, he wouldn't be around anymore. He was persecuted for his faith, and he died. And shortly thereafter, another one of his cohorts, Philip, went on to serve as well. He was also persecuted, but he was being used in a different way by God. And the point is that regardless of what we're called to, God wants us to embrace the responsibility to share and to live out the truths of the gospel. Sharing and serving. Those two words need to permeate our life. Now, as you look at your life and the backgrounds that you've come from, like Wayne had shared, and where you're currently at in your life, what is the greatest investment that you have ever made? What is the greatest investment that you have ever made with your life? Now, I'm not talking about your 401k which has taken a nosedive over the last 3 weeks. I'm not talking about things financially, although maybe you've made some very smart decisions financially. Fantastic. Good for you. I'm talking about something maybe a little bit more from the spiritual component of your life. Oftentimes what we think is investment from the standpoint of what have we done maybe tangibly for somebody else. And that might truly have value. Maybe the investment that you have in the lives of your kids or your grandkids. Certainly maybe the investment that you've put into your work, maybe into your marriage and relationship. All of those things have great value. Nothing wrong with any of that. But what we're talking about here is the biggest investment that you could make in your life is the dynamic of what you're doing spiritually. All of those other things are affected by what you're doing spiritually. I mean, what other decision is out there? Are we going to throw all of the stuff about God out the window and deconstruct in our faith and go to what? I've often wondered, what goes through the mind of an individual that decides that he or she has had enough of their faith and they're going to just toss it out the window? I mean, what's the other option? Is it to look inwardly at myself? Well, that's a dead end. I mean, certainly, from what Wayne had shared earlier, there's nothing that I can do in and of myself to bring me in relationship to God. Another religion? Why religion? Religion brings me to a dead-end street. It's all about relationship. But it is amazing how befuddled we become when we think there's another way to God, or that we just want to toss God out the window completely because we think we are the answer to our issues. There is no other way. It's Jesus or nothing. And the Bible is so clear about that picture. And so the investment that you and I make into our relationship with God is the most important investment you can make. And whatever that looks like and how it fleshes itself out. So before we go any further today, I want you to contemplate on what you are doing in your life right now as an investment in your relationship with God. What does that look like? And how is that investment affecting everything around you? God tells us that we are to embrace Him fully and completely and to let that reality affect and impact everything else that is going on in our world. We looked at Philip, and Philip, by the grace of God, embraced that reality to share the truth and to serve, and he ended up going to a people group that nobody else wanted to go to. God says, the first thing I'm going to have in mind for you, outside of helping these people, I want you to go to the Samaritans. They were half-breeds. They weren't considered full Jews. They were people that nobody else really wanted to go and witness to. But Philip said, absolutely, I'll follow up with that. And he surrendered his heart to do exactly what God wanted him to do. Now, I have to tell you, Virginia was not on my radar 33 years ago, coming down here. I like snow. I'm from the north. I'm staying up there. And I was pretty resolute about that. And so when we got a call to come down and visit with some folks down here in the middle of 1991, it wasn't a problem. We're just going down to visit our friends, the Berkmeyers, who have since relocated and are out in the Shenandoah Valley, doing well. And yet God started breaking our hearts. And I didn't want it. I wanted Him to send me where I wanted to go. And you see, I thought that was good enough. I thought by committing my life to the Lord, and then to saying to Him, listen, I've committed my life to You. Can I just have this little piece of the pie? Could I go to the place that I want to go? Just use me in that place. And the bottom line answer was, I don't think so. And what He did is He changed Barb's heart and mine to love Virginia and love the people and love being here. I could not do that on my own. But embracing him and surrounding my life in him made all of the difference because we thought it was absolutely impossible. So I don't know what your impossible looks like this morning. I don't know what you feel is precluding you from giving your 100% in the service of the King of Kings. I don't know. But I do know this. As you embrace your responsibility to share and to serve, God will open up the doors of opportunity. Steve Gugas shares a great story about what happened to his life when he first became a Christian. You'll have to go back and listen to the tape when he shared that during our men's breakfast. But the bottom line was Steve had a plan. And Steve was heading in this direction, and God shut it down. Completely shut it down. And sent him in a different direction that then opened up an opportunity that he could have never planned, never prepared for. And God said, are you willing to walk through that door that I have prepared for you? Are you willing to do that? That's what God often wants to do with all of us. Philip did that. He embraced his responsibility, but second of all, he surrendered his will. And this is where we're going to pick up things today. Acts chapter 8, beginning in verse 26. As for Philip, an angel of the Lord said to him, go south down to the desert road that runs from Jerusalem to Gaza. Now, wait a minute. He just asked him to go north up into the people of Samaria. He did that. Then he's being asked of God to turn all the way around and go the other way. He first gets sent out to people that nobody else wants to go to, and then he bypasses Jerusalem on the way back down to where there's no action at all. It says, on the desert road to Gaza. And you're thinking, Gaza? Isn't that relatively new? Absolutely not. Gaza's been around for thousands of years. Basically in the same location that it is now. And he meets this Ethiopian. Back in the day, Ethiopia was referred to as Bithynia. And it was primarily located in what is today southern Egypt and most of Sudan, maybe a little portion of extreme northern Ethiopia. Different geographical location. But this individual that we're going to meet, that Philip's going to meet, comes from a very unique area, and it's on the desert road, so there's no action. He went to a place where nobody wanted to go, and now God's sending him to a place where there isn't anybody, except for one person. Now, along our journey, you and I never really know exactly who we're going to meet. Sometimes we feel like, well, maybe we're not being used of God, but I'm telling you, God is often preparing the hearts and minds of individuals along our journey, and we have to open up our hearts and minds to see what he's doing. Verse 27. So he started out, and he met the treasurer of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority. Many of your versions use the word Candace as the queen's name, the queen of Ethiopia. And this eunuch had gone to Jerusalem to worship. So we're not exactly sure why he's there, but he's there worshiping in Jerusalem. But God had a bigger plan for him too. Let's read on, verse 28. And now he was returning. Seated in his carriage, he was reading aloud from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Now, of all things for him to be reading, I mean, he could have been reading anything in the Old Testament, but God had him reading specifically from the book of Isaiah, and it's going to get even more specific on the exact chapter that he was in, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. Have we gotten to the place where we're willing to surrender our will to God? Philip embraced his responsibility, but now he's at the point where he's literally surrendering his will. What God might be doing in your heart right now? Does God have something that he's got planned for you and you're putting your foot down because you don't want to hear it? Maybe it's a person. Maybe it's a place. Maybe it's something out there where he's calling you and you're not willing to do that. Whatever that is, being found in God's will is the absolute best place to be, even at times if it doesn't make that much sense. Here, this wasn't making a whole lot of sense. Jerusalem was where it was happening. But no, I want you to go to these people because nobody else really wants to talk to them, but they need the gospel as well. And oh, by the way, when you're done up there, I'm going to send you in the middle of nowhere, where maybe you don't think you're going to be effective at all, but I have a divine appointment that I have set up specifically for you. My switching of colleges, to be honest with you, I didn't know exactly what God was doing at all. I mean, most of you know, in my head, it was meteorology or nothing. And so the University of New York had a great meteorology program. And I was going to forge my way through the school and eventually get involved with what became known as the Weather Channel. It was just starting back then, back in the late 70s and early 80s. And God stopped me in my tracks after spending some time up there. And he says, I got a different plan for you. Are you willing to walk through that door? And I did not. But I'll never forget waking my parents up August of 1981. I was supposed to go to school the next day. And I walked in, woke them up, and I said, I don't know what's going on with me. All that I know is I'm not supposed to go back. And I only knew of one Christian school. One. I didn't know if they would accept me. They were just about ready to start their semester. Sometimes God calls you in the middle of what you're doing and wants you to make a decision. Even though that decision might not make sense. But each time you walk through, God opens up doors of opportunity that you couldn't see at the time. I couldn't see it at the time. I thought that was going to be a dead-end street. And yet opening up that door, first day on campus, is when I met my wife, Barb. If nothing else came out of that experience, that was awesome. And here we are, 40-some years later, being married, and God doing an amazing work. That was great. I didn't want to go to South Carolina. I didn't want to leave New York. I didn't want to come to Virginia. And God has a different plan. Maybe you're exactly where you need to be in every component of your life. Wonderful. But maybe God is asking you to step out like Philip. Maybe to go to a people that nobody else wants to go to. Maybe to a place where you're just not sure about because it doesn't seem like it makes sense. But if God is the one behind it, he will open up the doors of opportunity and it will eventually make sense. He embraced his responsibility. He surrendered his will to the Lord. But it continued. Verses 29 and 30. He anticipated a work of God. Sometimes what we do is when God is working, we dig our heels in, and instead of anticipating God continuing to work where he's sending us, we just say, I can't believe he's sending us here, or I can't believe he's put us in that situation. Wait a minute. We can't stop there. If God is sending and directing, he's also doing a work. He's not going to just stop. And so he's basically asking Philip, anticipate me to do something. You've surrendered your will. I'm not finished. 29 and 30. The Holy Spirit said to Philip, go over and walk alongside the carriage. Now, this is a direct command. Here's this person. I want you to go immediately and come alongside. Now, those of you who are not people, persons, this would be just like a harrowing event for you. You going up to meet somebody that you don't know? I mean, you're stage left. You're out of here. I mean, you having to meet people that you've never had any interaction with before? Absolutely not. I'm not doing it. And yet, God calls Philip to do exactly that. Sometimes the Lord puts us in precarious situations, but he always provides. There's always something that he's doing in the middle of his work in our life. Are we prepared to hear from him and respond? He says, go up. The word here means to draw near. I mean, to get really close. I want you to respond immediately and talk to this guy. Now, what's interesting is, let's go to verse 30. Philip runs over and he hears the man reading from the prophet Isaiah. Do you understand what you're reading? There's another word that's used. If you could go back to 29 real quickly. So he goes over and then he walks along beside. Now, it's a very interesting phrase that's used here, not used very frequently in the New Testament. It means to stick like glue. So he responds and he says, God, I'll go there in the middle of nowhere. Okay, I've seen the guy that you want me to talk to who I've never met before. Oh, and oh, by the way, I hear him reading from the book of Isaiah, but I really don't have a clue what you want me to do with this yet. You tell me, go and get close to this guy, and I mean really close. Go over to the chariot, and then I want you to be stuck like glue to this guy because I've got something of a message and a ministry for you. Maybe sometimes what we do is we say, okay, Lord, maybe what we'll do is we won't get too close to those people that we don't like and we don't know. So maybe we'll do something else. But sometimes God wants you to get right in the person's face. And I mean, that can be extraordinarily uncomfortable. What if this was you? Maybe you were going to be catching the next chariot north, back into Jerusalem. Maybe you'd be flagging down the next camel. I don't know what it would be, but for Philip, he was embracing his responsibility, he was surrendering his will, and he was anticipating God to do an amazing work in what was going on. But it doesn't stop there as well. Let's take a look at verses 31 through 34. He's willing to share his story. The man replied, How can I understand what I'm reading unless somebody instructs me? And he urges Philip to come up into the carriage and sit with him. Now it's really getting personal. I mean, it's one thing to go. It's another thing to come alongside of the carriage and not lose sight of it, if you will. But now the guy says, why don't you sit next to me? Can we talk about this situation? When God opens doors of opportunity, we need to be ready and willing to walk through them. Verse 32. The passage of Scripture that he's been reading was this. It could have been anywhere in Isaiah 53. In fact, it could have been anywhere in the Old Testament, but no, it's here. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb is silent before his shearers, he did not open his mouth. Next verse. He was humiliated. He received no justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. Verse 34. The eunuch asked Philip, tell me, was this prophet talking about himself or somebody else? Holy cow, what a setup. Could you imagine having somebody invite you over to ride in their chariot? Okay, your train or boat or car or plane, whatever it is. And the person's reading something and they ask you about this passage of Scripture. I mean, this is just laying it right on a platter. This is Isaiah 53 talking about Jesus. I mean, Philip, at this point, he's probably bursting at the seams. Look at what happens next. So beginning with this same Scripture, Philip tells him the good news about Jesus. This is awesome. This is where we need to be. We need to come alongside. When God wants us to be in pursuit of Him and others, we need to be ready to share the story of the gospel and our own story as well. Each one of us, if we know Christ as our Savior, we have a story. We have a story to tell. And sometimes God puts us in positions where we need to be able to share that. Jack and Lindsay went over to Cote d'Ivoire in Africa. I mean, to be honest with you, their decisions, God was already making, sorry, you've made the decision, you surrendered your will, buck up because you're going to be meeting all kinds of people that you've never known before, in some cases, languages that you've not understood before, and they walked through it, they've embraced it multiple times, and God is doing a great work in their life. We're going to be able to hear from Jack and Lindsay very, very shortly. They're coming back from West Africa for a number of months. They'll be with us on the 28th of this month for a very short testimony, and then we're going to give them the floor on the 19th of May to talk about everything that's going on. And it's been awesome. And maybe that's not for everybody. Maybe just interfacing with individuals on a daily basis is where God will take you and me. But we need to be willing to share our story. That's what this is all about. And so he shares with him about Jesus. Next verse. As they rode along, they came to some water in the middle of the desert. Again, it's the Bible, so I believe it. Look, there's some water. Why can't I be baptized? Now, he's jumping ahead a little bit. Some of your versions do not have the next verse. Verse 37, you're reading along and you're thinking, oh, okay. And then you skip over to verse 38. And that's unfortunate. This is known as a textual variant. And some of the older translations have verse 37. So we're going to do that today. Verse 37 doesn't negate or change any of the theology of the rest of the Bible. It supports what's already there. Philip says, if you believe with all your heart, then you may. And he answered, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I mean, this is the Ethiopian coming to faith in Christ. Notice that Philip doesn't say, yeah, jump in the water first. No, he says, no, we're not going to do that first. You need to come to faith first, and then we'll go into the water. The reason we baptize here after faith is a lot of times based on the examples of Scripture that we see when people come to faith, and then they say, listen, I've come to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior, and I'm going to be baptized by immersion, the picture of the death to sin and the resurrection of the newness of life in Christ. And so that's why we do this afterwards, not just because of this verse, but other examples that are found in the Scriptures as well. We have six families that are already lined up to be baptized. One of them is going to be baptized here, right behind me. We can get that water up to 75 to 80 in no trouble at all. The other folks want to do the river, which is great, but you know my policy, okay? It's got to be like June to October 1st, 70 plus in the water, okay? Otherwise, we're throwing Justin in the water, and he can baptize if you want it to be colder than that. But that's exciting. So maybe if you're out there and you're thinking, you know, I've never been baptized before. I know Jesus as my Lord and Savior, but it's about time, like the Ethiopian, hey, there's some water over there. What's prohibiting me from getting baptized? Well, to be honest with you, nothing. Share your faith with me in front of the church, small groups, fantastic. Write it to me, send it to me, however that looks, and then we will have the privilege of baptizing you. And one of the things that we love to do here, as we saw this past summer, is we had the parents get out in the river. We had 11 people baptized back in the fall, and we just you bring the parents out there, the kids, the parents are baptizing each other, then they're baptizing the kids, and I'm just loving all of it. I'm speaking, we're talking about baptism. Now, I love to baptize, but I love to watch families baptize each other. The Bible doesn't say who has to baptize. I'm not the only authorized person to do that. If you want to be out there in the river or back in here, then we'll make that happen. This is exciting, and it's exciting for him. Verse 38. As we wrap this up, he orders the carriage to stop, and they go down into the water, and Philip baptizes him. Verse 39. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord, you thought him going to Samaria was a little crazy. Then he turns around and sends them down to a desert road into Gaza, but he's never experienced anything like this. And guess what? Neither of you. Suddenly, the Spirit of the Lord snatched him away. It's a beam me up, Scotty moment, okay? And he is out of here. The eunuch never sees him again, and he goes on his way rejoicing. This word for snatched is found four times in your Bible. Probably the most familiar one is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, when the Bible says the Lord himself will come back with a shout and bring us up in the clouds, and he says, and he will snatch you up. Whew, that's awesome. You and I, if it happens between the time before we pass on in this life, we will then experience what he experienced, this gone. And the Bible says he transports him to someplace else. that takes him on the road back north again to a ministry along the coast into Caesarea. Amazing. Philip's life, we don't know that much about him, but I'm telling you, in this short segment, wow, how awesome. He embraced his responsibility to follow the Lord. He surrendered his will. He anticipated that God would work in his life. He shared his story. And you know what we find out in the very end? Some people that you and I are going to talk to, they're ready to receive the gospel. I mean, they're ready. God has been priming them. Other people, they're not ready. They need time. And other people, they're just going to think you're nuts. And that's okay. So we pray that God would use us in whatever way possible, because people are always in those categories. When I trusted Christ in January of 1984, I have to tell you, God was working on me for a number of years. I mean, I was prime fruit. And when Pastor Earl Green at Calvary Baptist Church of Belton, South Carolina, I don't say that quite right, I need a little bit more of a southern draw, Belton, South Carolina, when he gave the message that day, I mean, there was I was ready to almost jump out of my seat. God was working on me. Maybe God's working on somebody in here. Maybe you need more time. Maybe you think we're all nuts. But the gospel is the only way. The gospel of Jesus Christ is it. Are we willing today to take up the mantle to share and to serve as individuals in our own backyards, maybe a place overseas, maybe everything in between? Maybe God will send us to a people that nobody wants to go to. Maybe God will send us to an obscure place that you think, God, there's no action here. But God's always in the details. And he's got something specific for each one of us to share and to serve. Let's take the mantle up and do that as individuals and as a church for his glory. Let's pray. Joey will close us out with a song. Lord, we are grateful to be here today, and wherever we're at, maybe we need to respond to you. Maybe we're digging our heels in, and we're not willing to surrender our will. Maybe we're not anticipating you at work at all. We're just kind of going through life and doing things each and every day, but our spiritual tentacles are not up. We're not really sensing that you're doing anything because we're really not even being aware of it, and so help our hearts to be very centered on that. Help us to anticipate that you will work. Help us to be at a time and place where we're willing to share our faith, even at a moment's notice. God, we just want to be used of you in a wonderful way, just like Philip, but we need your help to do it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let's stand.
comes down on me. Hallelujah, all my stains are washed away.
They're washed away.
Hallelujah, grace like rain falls down on me. Hallelujah, all my stains are washed away.
They're washed away.
When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing your praise than when we first away.
Love that song. Great way to end. Thanks so much for being here. We have middle school and high school here tonight, 5 o'clock to 7. We have men's breakfast this coming Saturday on the 20th from 7:30 to 9. Again, we start promptly, we end promptly. Joe DeLisi, former owner of Joe's Pizza, will be our speaker this coming weekend. We'd love for you to sign up for that as well. And then we have Trey, we've got Tim, we've got others that are part of the robotics team. There's others here as well. Wade's up top. We had a bunch in the first service. They leave tomorrow, Tuesday or Wednesday, to go to Houston for Worlds. So pray for their safety. Pray for the team as well. Maybe they'll get a chance to share the truth of the gospel. And also to do very, very well. I know you're anticipating that. You're not too prideful about it, but you're anticipating doing well. And you're the driver, is that right, of the crazy robot? Let me tell you something. If you've ever seen what they have to do, they have these live feeds, and I would be driving that thing all over the place. You have just great stability there with guiding the robot. So blessings to all of you as you head out. Enjoy the rest of your week. We'll see you all next Sunday. Thanks for being here.